So, and how did you get into The Informant? You got into that years and years ago? Is that what I'm getting?
Yeah, it must have been 2001 or 2002. I was driving around and I heard This American Life, and they did a great piece on Mark Whitaker and on Kurt Eichenwald's book, and I sort of drove around in circles not far from where we're currently sitting. Mm-hmm. It was really late for brunch, and then went to Book Soup and bought the book and went home and started reading it, and the next day called my agent and said, this is something I really want to do, and we tracked down the rights and I went and pitched it.
So at that point, a comedy or a drama?
Well, if you listen to Ira's piece on This American Life, mm-hmm. there's really no way to talk about what transpired with Whitaker, you know, in a completely serious way. Mm-hmm. And so I think what always drew me to the story was, although, you know, there are some really serious aspects to what went on, his behavior is so erratic that, you know, and when we were making the movie, we would sometimes look at each other and we would say, there's really no way to do this scene mm-hmm. in any other way than comically. I mean, it's not the same story as Aaron Brockovich or, you know, The Insider. Right. So this was not going to be that kind of whistleblower story, no matter what our approach was.
So were tone issues an issue from the beginning for you as a writer and then as trying to sell a thing?
Tone issue. I don't really know. I guess I've always been drawn to stories that have sort of a mixture of tones. The movie that I did for HBO, you know, I think to its credit and probably to its failing, was a movie that was both comic and tragic.
Why do you think to its failing?
I mean,
is the definition of the failing for you how it was, what the ratings were or what the reviews were?
No, you know, it was actually pretty well reviewed. I think it's a struggle in this marketplace and for a lot of people to be challenged to go into a room and experience things that are both comic and tragic, mm-hmm. you know. And so I've always been drawn to material that has kind of a combination of tones. I mean, when I look at the movies that probably made me want to be in movies, like Cuckoo's Nest mm-hmm. or, you know, Dog Day Afternoon, there are very funny moments in both of those movies, mm-hmm. You know, that I remember laughing at, but I also remember finding both of those movies very sad at times.
You do have a kind of New York screenwriter thing about you in Los Angeles. Is that a natural dichotomy, or?
maybe it's because I'm from the Midwest, so I'm halfway in between. So maybe it's the Minnesota thing in me. I don't know. I mean, I think that I can only write things that really I'm passionate about. When I heard. You know, this American Life story, I knew that this was something that I wanted to do. I could see how this would be a movie.
Right.
Even though the book is 500 and some pages, and there were people when I started pitching it who said, how are you possibly going to sort of compress this? And because Whitaker's behavior was so erratic, mm-hmm. there's a lot of different tangents that you could pursue.
Right.
But I never... You know, even when I worked with Matt on The Bourne Ultimatum, mm-hmm. I love that character, and it's really fun for me to do those kinds of movies as well.
So is that a linchpin of how this all came together? Was it a coincidence that you were all...
No, the way that it sort of went was, I pitched The Informant to Section 8, which was Steven and George Clooney's company, mm-hmm. And Steven, they bought it for Steven, and I started working on it. And then through that collaboration, at one point, Steven asked me to help him with Ocean's 12. So I did some work on Ocean's 12 as well.
So how does that collaboration start? Does he just say, go do what you want to do, or this is the tone that I'm looking for, or how does that...
You know, We actually talked about this the other day, and he said one of the things that I think happens in any sort of artistic endeavor is you make choices about what you're not going to do.
Mm-hmm.
And he had just made Aaron Brockovich, and The Insider had just come out, and
right.
So we knew we weren't going to do a whistleblower story like that. And because there was no way to talk about what Whitaker did
mm-hmm.
Without laughing, it seemed like it should be a comedy. And,
mm-hmm.
and you know, Steven started referencing Richard Lester comedies and encouraged me to think of the story that way.
Mm-hmm.
And then really the wonderful piece of guidance that he gave me near the end of our first meeting was go and write the version of this story that only you would write. Which, you know, was a great invitation to
mm-hmm.
go and explore. And so we started, and then he did Ocean's 12, and he had, I think at that point he'd already read a draft of mine,
mm-hmm.
and he said, you know, there's some work I think you could do on this script, so will you come and help out? So I did that, and at that point Matt, I think, had been exposed to my script, or certainly the book,
mm-hmm.
and we had early on, Stephen had said to Matt, you know, what do you think about Eichenwald's book? And so Matt was always in.
Mm-hmm.
And we would, you know, we all started talking about it, and we would talk about it during Bourne and, you know, other things.
So what is it like to go into The Money Show and, like, Ocean's 12 and just go in and play? I mean, you come in and just kind of, like, help? And is it fun?
Yeah, I mean, I think that, you know, even when I made television commercials, there'd be days that we'd go out and we'd shoot commercials for $10,000, and then there'd
mm-hmm.
be commercials that cost $1 million. And there's a way to have fun doing either one
mm-hmm.
as long as you don't, you know, pretend you're doing the other at that moment.
Right.
You know, I think that, you know, if you dump out half the box of crayons and just work with the ones that are left, you can still make a really cool picture, unless you're making a picture that's dependent on one of the crayons that you've just lost.
Right.
And so, you know, Oceans, it's just as hard, I think, to make a popcorn kind of bigger studio movie
mm-hmm.
as there is making something, you know, that's a little left of center.
Yeah.
And so I don't, you know.
The Ocean's a little left of center.
Yeah, I mean.
That's why. I mean, I think actually each movie got a little bit further
yeah.
into Steven Land.
Yeah, which I'm a big fan of. So I think that it's fun. And he's always sort of, you know, allowed me to do that when I write. I think he likes it when I sort of go off in different directions.
So is Bourne a more restrictive universe to get into?
Bourne's really fun because, and Matt and I had a conversation at one point about Bourne before I even was involved in the third one, where we talked about how the great thing about Jason Bourne is that he doesn't have anyone to talk to.
Mm-hmm.
And that he's, you know, I mean, Superman is Lois Lane. Everybody seems to have somebody. Batman
right.
is Robin. Or, so, you know, Albert? Alfred?
Alfred.
Alfred.
Albert is good, though.
but Jason Bourne, you know, doesn't have anyone to talk to, and
mm-hmm.
if he does start talking to somebody, they usually die. And existentially, I always thought that that was really great.
Mm-hmm.
And it also means in the third act, when he does get to start speaking, there's a lot of, you know, anticipation, which is fun as a writer to play with, or, you know, when you're constructing a story.
Mm-hmm.
So there's, you know, again, it's like sometimes the things you don't get to write are, you know, the aspects of the story or the
right.
limitations of the character are really appealing.